I want to ask you two questions. Let me start with Hillary, because you're a bit of an expert on this issue. What did you make of, and how do you think voters are going to receive the Hillary Clinton discussion about gun control in relation to what is obviously a terror attack in California?
You know, Hillary Clinton is all about hypocrisy. 3 weeks ago, she put out a gun control proposal, an extensive gun control proposal, in which she said that if you are accused of domestic abuse, you should not be allowed to own a gun, which means Hillary could never own a gun because, as I prove in my book, The Clinton's War on Women, she has punched, kicked, slapped, scratched, and thrown hard objects at her husband. I have multiple Secret Service agents going on the record talk about what they have witnessed. So she is about the hypocrisy. One of the reasons I resigned from Donald Trump's campaign in August is because I wanted there to be no confusion that my book on Hillary, The Clinton's War on Women, was somehow a Trump-connected project or involved, you know, as it would be. I do think it would be beneficial to Donald. But yesterday she made perhaps the biggest mistake, because she said 3 weeks ago that if a woman is raped, in this case she was talking to college girls, she said, you deserve to be believed. And then a woman in New Hampshire only yesterday asked her, well, what about Paula Jones, Juanita Broderick, Kathy Willey? Don't they deserve to be believed? And she said, well, they deserve to be believed initially until evidence shows otherwise. Well, there is no evidence, zero evidence, that those women weren't sexually assaulted by her husband. In fact, Paula Jones was paid $850,000 by Bill Clinton in a legal settlement.
Yeah.
To me, that says guilty. She hasn't heard the last of this issue by a long shot.
I agree. I think it's incredible hypocrisy, and they throw these words around about war on women, and they're just covering up what they've got in their own past. But the voters, up to a certain point, I think were really buying into it. And I think that it sounds like to me that Donald Trump has really changed the game. So talk quickly about the relationship between Donald Trump and Chris Christie. I think, you know, Chris Christie really focused on the one statement that Donald Trump made about the thousands, but he did not say and didn't go as far as saying Trump was lying about this homegrown terrorism issue. And I wonder if there's in a future alliance between the two of them.
Well, there's certainly some shift in Christie's position, because initially, you may remember, he said he didn't know or couldn't remember.
Yeah.
And now he says, no, he thinks Trump is wrong. Look, they have a long relationship. I do think that Chris Christie's smart enough to know that if he attacks Trump, he's going to get a mouthful of the George Washington Bridge and the shady deal he did with Jerry Speciale in Passaic County to trade a job, which, by the way, is a felony. So if he really wants to talk about vulnerabilities, I think he'd be in trouble. And Trump has no compunction. He'll go right in his face. In his face.
Now, do you think it's more style on Trump's side, or is it that he is hitting the right message and just the timing? I mean, the two times he has been outspoken about Muslim issues, you had one followed by the Paris attacks, and now you've got San Bernardino. It's almost like he is speaking to exactly what is happening right now in the world.
Yeah, it's almost like he swallowed a horseshoe. It's extraordinary. I mean, it is an extraordinary break, because just at the time when there's a public debate about how tough we should be on ISIS, you had these horrific murders in San Bernardino, and yet another government cover-up. It's like when the guy in Oklahoma killed multiple people on a military base. We were told it was a workplace altercation.
Wasn't that incredible? It sounds to me, though, Roger, that the American people are starting to change, and whether you are a Democrat or a Republican, the one thing that is nonpartisan is your desire to be safe in your community. And I think that is what will ultimately unite us. You know, you look over in Israel and other places, and they fight like cats and dogs over policy. One thing they agree on is how to keep people safe.
Yeah, it's interesting, for example, that both parties in Israel, the left and the right party, were opposed to the Iranian deal,
in
which we gave $150 billion to terrorists, as if they won't spend that for bad purposes.
Yeah.
I think those who underestimate Trump do so at their own peril. It is not only the fact that he's riding the crest of this Islamic extremism issue. It is the voters think the entire system is broken, corrupted. They think it's a cesspool. They think all these candidates are jumping to the tune of the latest billionaire, the latest super PAC. And Trump, I think, is viewed as a guy who's completely and financially independent. He doesn't need anyone's money. Therefore, no one owns him. You can't buy him. You can't bully him. He would be impervious to influence in Washington. He'd be refreshing.
All right.
An American president who actually works for the people, not for the bankers and the lobbyists.
All right. Roger Stone, New York Times bestselling author. Your new book coming out, Jeb and the Bush Crime Family. We'll be interested to read that. I would love to talk to you again after the next Republican debate, which is coming up on the 15th on CNN. So I'd love to loop back around with you, see how Trump did, break it down, see how between Trump and Christie, if the sands are shifting at all in direction for either of these guys.
Count on it.